trapped in her hair. She'd never seen war, but she imagined it was like the alley behind a butcher's shop, only better because she liked animals more than she liked people. On a battlefield, the flies all danced on bodies that had the chance to fight back. She made her way in a loop, moving through Newmarket and east to the outskirts around the temple, where the gods of the city were worshipped and the grain stored against emergency. Emergency, moving fast, but also through every crowd at every corner on the off chance she see Alice in it. She passed through streets and alleys, thin private yards and streets that had been closed off and forgotten, all to avoid the blue cloaks who might stop her and ask for proof she paid the city's tax on her work. She hadn't. Riverport, Newmarket, the temple, Seawater. There was no place east of the Cahoon that Samish didn't know, but she didn't brag about it. Pride was the poison of Long Hill. To want better than life and death in the narrow, winding alleys was disloyalty. To try for even so small an escape as work in Seawater seemed complicit in the city's contempt for Long Hill and the Inlik who lived there. She knew to keep her ambitions to herself. She came to the Whetstone Man's shed just before midday. The heat was climbing and the air had a thick humidity that stuck her tunic against her back. The afternoon would be as hot as midsummer, even if the night came a little sooner. The shed had no windows, and the air inside was sluggish. "What do we have today?" Arnald asked. He was older, with white hair in tight curls that stood away from his scalp, like they were trying to get away from him. She liked his voice. He always seemed like he was on the edge of laughing at something that wasn't hers. Samish sat on the floor at his feet and undid the satchel's ties. Shears from Taylor's shop under Chandler's Guild Hall. She said to tell you these were for wool, not cotton. This one hooked one hair is from Cobbler's boy by the temple's gate. Hard latter or soft. This one's for hand, for heart. I got another one here for soft. Soft has the red handle. There, the use rule from the new market butchers. Arnold nodded, then pointed to the last remaining blade. "That?" he asked. Samish held up the ritual dagger with its false runes and glass gemstones. Fortune teller. Why do they need an edge on it? Sometimes they bleed a chicken. Arnal opened the little water sluice that kept his stone wet. Samish stood, brushed the dust off her legs, and turned towards the door. "You are not staying to run them home?" Arnal asked. "I'll be back. I have to check something first." "That is division," the priest said. "Not only for the dying who passed from this world to the coming cycle, but within each of us we are trapped between the life we had. When our friend, our lover, our parent, our child was with us, this diminished world without them, we are split in two, and bringing ourselves back to wholeness is a spiritual work of mourning. Mourning, mourning." Daru's body was already gone. The priest had burned it to ashes over the course of 3 days, chanting and praying over the kiln as it worked. What had been a man now fit in a box of stained scrap oak, no longer than her forearm. The pews in the little common temple had half a dozen people in them. Ali's mother was there, one of Daro's old lovers sat apart, her eyes shining and bloodshot. A few others from the quarter who had known the man either liked him better than Samish guessed, or enjoyed the ritual for its own sake, sat together gossiping quietly. Alice wasn't there. In the name of all the gods of Githamar, the priest intoned, and in the name of the man we knew as Daro, and in the names of those who remain in this world, to carry his memory on, we now sing his soul to safety. The death song was a single melody. The priest's voice was harsh and low. The words were old in lick. Samish had heard them before, but she didn't know what they meant. She lowered her head and pretended to pray to gods she didn't believe in, on behalf of a soul she didn't care about. All she really meant was, please let Alice be all right. At the end, the priest took a blade and carved a mark in the box. As Daro had been in the name of his life, his death mark would be the name of his absence from the world. The priest rubbed bright yellow wax to fill the new carved grooves, and the full rites were complete. Neither the water nor the sky nor any spirit had claim on Daro's soul now. To Samish mind, that put him ahead of everyone else in the room. Ali's mother went up to claim her son's ashes, but the priest only took her hand, mourning soft words in a kind voice. He then passed the box over. Samish saw a flush of humiliation in the old woman's face and felt something like joy leap up in her chest. The only reason Samish would think that he wouldn't give the box to Daro's mother was the old woman hadn't paid for the rites, which meant that even though Ali wasn't here now, she wouldn't be. Ali would come for Daro's ashes, and when she did, Samish would be there. the others left, and the priest cleared ceremonial tools away. Samish stayed. She'd take the knives back to the right places. In the morning, if she had to. The priest looked at her, a gestion. The priest looked at her, a question in his slow, heavy eyes. She said nothing and waited before the empty altar with 100 different gods and no one. It was dark before she came. The public door scraped and Alice came in like a thief. The cloak over her head might have hidden her from someone who didn't know her. Hadn't watched her from the corners of their eyes. Wasn't hoping to see her there. But Samish's heart tightened and relaxed in the same moment. Before Ali had taken 3 steps towards the altar, the priest came forward to meet her. The box of Daros ashes in his hand. Ali took it, spoke a few words too softly to be heard, and let the priest return to his duties. She traced the death mark with her fingertips and let the hood fall back a few inches. In the warm light, the darkness under her eyes looked like bruises, but they were likely only sleeplessness. Samish stood and Ali started, noticing her for the first time. The fear in her expression was like Samish had snuck up on a cat without being heard, and tugged its tail. For a moment, she was certain Ali would race for the streets and be gone. Samish stood very still, met her friend's gaze, and nodded slowly. She could see Alice awakening something in her mind, but she had no idea what it was. Ali moved forward with twitch, fast, uncertain steps, crowing crowding close to her. Her eyes looked wild in the soft light. "What are you doing here?" Ali said, her voice brittle and sharp. "Looking for you." "Why? Who wants me found?" I'm not hired. I'm just... You were gone, and I didn't know where.